Hi everyone, in the kitchen today. I'll be doing some cooking towards the end of this video. But to begin with, I've made a contraption. I want to show you my contraption. It's going in the hoop house, and I'm going to try to grow some fall or winter greens, and hopefully they will overwinter in it and start again in the spring. So I think it's kind of interesting. We'll see if it actually works. It didn't cost me anything to make anyway. You'll see what I mean in just a minute. And the last of the tomatoes have been harvested, and I've been trying to save up enough tomatoes to make Brendan's tomato soup, and that's what the cooking segment is. I hope you'll try Brendan's tomato soup. I'm also going to put the link up. So without further ado here, let's move on to the thing that I built and out into the hoop house to use it. I'll bet you've never seen one as nice as that. I'm not sure what to call it. Mini greenhouse or some sort of a cold frame. I don't know. Didn't cost me anything anyway. I bought a new box of wood screws, 3-inch wood screws, to screw all of the tubifores together with. And that cost me $7 or $8, and I only used half of them. So that was the total expense. The rest of it is things that I had laying around. I tore down an old Lexan greenhouse this spring, and I saved most of the panels. If you're not familiar with what Lexan is, it's some sort of plastic product, but it's double-sided with the air channels down the center. If I can get close enough to show you what I mean here, if you can see those in there or not. Probably not, but each one of those lines is a tube, an air channel that goes the whole way through, so I suppose it has some insulating value. And they were never clear. When it was new 20, 25 years ago, it was translucent at best, and a lot of them have yellowed quite a bit in the sun. These are the better ones, believe it or not. A little dirty in places. They've been sitting out here all summer. And earwigs love to get in those channels. I'm going to leave it out for a while before I put it in the greenhouse, I guess. Or the hoop house, whatever I want to call it. I usually call it a hoop house. My plan is to start... It's being inspected. My plan is to start a couple of hardy greens that Patrick on One Yard Revolution grows, and he quite often successfully brings them through the winter in a cold frame. So I'm thinking inside the hoop house, and then this on one of the beds, I'm going to plant Mache and Claytonia. I've never eaten Claytonia. I've had Mache in France. It's a popular salad green in France. I've never seen it in shops around here. I think I grew it a number of years ago. I can't really recall what it tasted like, but I'm sure if it's a green, I'll enjoy it. Anyway, I'm going to get this set up in a day or so in the hoop house with Mache and Claytonia planted under it. It's far from airtight, which is good in a way. I want some circulation. Nothing opens like you can't, like with a cold frame, if you normally open the top. It's all solid, just made out of scrap 2x4s, some laths, and the pieces from the old greenhouse there, the Lexan. So I guess if it does get too hot inside of it, which it quite possibly will this fall or early in the spring, I will just have to block it up on one end to get more air circulation going through. But it's moving out to the hoop house maybe tomorrow, and the next clip will show it installed with the Claytonia and Mache planted inside it. In the hoop house, removing the tomato plants, and that is the last of the ripe tomatoes for this year. Hopefully there's enough there to make at least a scaled down version of Brendan's excellent tomato soup. I guess we'll find that out before we get to the end of the video anyway. All of the tomatoes were growing in either smart pots or those large plastic grow bags, but I wanted to show you what I found with a couple of the smart pots when I brought them out to empty them. Smart pots set on top of soil, which these are on top of raised beds in the hoop house, will always send roots out through the bottom of the pot into the soil down below for additional nutrients and moisture and whatever. But I have found two of them that were like this one. The root came out, as you can see. It is very long. That one, I probably got 4 feet of root there on that one. And there was more. It broke off when I was just pulling it up and bringing it out of the hoop house. But I only had two that are like that. They've all got roots, but those are really quite substantial roots. Well, there's the tomato plants removed, and the new, whatever you want to call it, greenhouse, cold frame, whatever, installed. I haven't planted anything yet, and I'm going to show that to you in a second. But I prepared the soil under it, loosened it with a garden fork, and then I added a good amount of the organic fertilizer that I use, and some agricultural lime. And I have placed it where it is, off to one side in the bed, because I think that makes it easier to get access to it for watering it and checking what's going on inside. So I'll open it up, show you how I open it up, and then I'll take you in closer for a better look at the planting. Well, if that last clip was a bit on the foggy side, I think the lens had a bit of condensation on it. It's very humid in here in the hoop house today. Cool outside and very warm inside. First one that I'm planting here is the Claytonia. I think I might have been saying Claytonia before. I'd say what that is, a disease maybe, but looking at the seed packet, it's Claytonia, I guess. Very small seeds. I'm not going to try to make like a drill or channel to put them in. I'm just going to broadcast them over the surface. Lots of them, so I guess I may as well put lots of them there. Tiny, tiny little black seeds. And I'll just pat the soil down. That will get enough of them into the ground anyway. And the mache, or corn salad, however you want to call it. I will make some little drills for it. They're, I don't know, about the size of a radish seed, maybe a bit smaller than a radish seed. Yeah, a bit smaller, I guess, but still fairly large seed. Thicker in places than in other places. It always seems to happen with me when I'm seeding something. That'll do. I'll water them in. Just water, no fertilizer or anything in this water, just clean tap water. I don't think I have said so far anything about the date. This is the third day of October. Probably be another week or more before I get this video up on YouTube, so I will say that it is. It's the 3rd of October when I'm starting these things. Hopefully in the fall here sometime we'll be able to have a look at them and see them growing. I anyway, I'm going to put the remote sensor for my thermometer in the cabin. It's an indoor-outdoor thermometer. Last year I had that remote sensor in with the fig trees, but I think I'll put it under this, and that will give me an accurate idea of what the temperature is underneath of this thing, not only in the cold weather, but right now when we get sunny days and it's still fairly warm. Well, there it is, closed up. We'll have a look in a week or two to see if anything comes up. Well, I'm going to try my hand at making Brendan's excellent tomato soup. I haven't tasted it yet, but it certainly looks good when he makes it. I'll run down through the ingredients here, and what I will be reading to you is the ingredients from Brendan's recipe, and I'll put a link up here to his version of the soup, and you should watch it because, of course, Brendan has a good comedy routine that goes along with his. Like Brendan did, I'm ending up making probably close to a double batch, but the ingredients that I'm giving you are the original for a single batch. 1.5 pounds of diced potato, 700 grams of diced potato, and I'm using Russian blue potatoes. When Brendan made this soup online, he used quite a bit of green tomatoes, ended up with a green tomato soup that was very interesting. I'm going to be using blue potatoes and yellow and red tomatoes, so I'm really not quite sure. I suspect it's going to be quite a blue soup. One medium onion, diced, just roughly diced, because these are all going to be cooked down until very soft, and then it will be blended and sieved. One clove of garlic and 2 chilies. I've doubled everything, and I'm using my Thai chilies, which are getting nice and ripe now. I'll soon have to start picking them and drying them so they won't freeze and spoil. And one clove of garlic, I'm using 2, and it's that large garlic that I grow, the Northern Quebec variety. That's something I should say before I go any further. I am very pleased that everything that I'm using in this came out of my garden, including the basil. 2, what does he say here? 1 teaspoon of dried basil, and I'm using basil that I grew this summer and dried, and the fragrance of it is wonderful. It's a mixture of different basils, 3 or 4 different kinds, and I hung them up, you might have seen, in the cabin and dried them. When you buy dried basil at the store in one of those little spice bottles, to me it never seems to smell very good. This is marvelous. I wish I had been drying it earlier. I didn't start drying it until the season was almost over. Next year I'll dry a lot more. And not in Brendan's recipe, but I'm adding it just because I have it, is green celery soup, the herb. It's still doing quite well in the hoopos, so I'm adding, I don't know, I guess that's probably 1/4 cup or so of green celery soup. The tomatoes, of course, I think that's just about everything here. Oh no, the stock. 1/2 pint of vegetable stock. I'm using, or 1/2 pint of any stock, Brendan said. I'm using a vegetable stock. Some olive oil. I'm using a good extra virgin olive oil. Salt and pepper to taste. And I think that's about it. So we'll now move on and see the process. Well, it's a heavy-bottomed pot, and I have the fire going under it already. It's heating up. I don't tend to measure the amounts of oil that I use, but Brendan says 2 tablespoons, so if I'm doubling, I guess I can go with at least 4. And to that, you add your potatoes, purple potatoes. They taste fine, there's nothing wrong with them, it's just I can't get used to seeing a purple potato on my plate. They're dry, quite flavorful potato, and I keep joking and saying perhaps that's what's wrong with Putin. He ate too many Russian blue potatoes. The onions and the garlic and the chilies. gonna saute this for 15 minutes or so until the onions and the potatoes have at least started to soften. So. We'll come back after that's had 15 minutes. It's been less than 10 minutes, I guess. The onions seem to have sweated down nicely. There's a lot of starch in these Russian blue potatoes, and it's starting to caramelize on the bottom, so I don't want it to burn. That was my dried basil. Green celery soup. Just put them in for a minute or so before I add the tomatoes to let the heat bring out some of their flavors. And the tomatoes. Now, at this point, I'm going to add some salt, maybe a bit of pepper. The salt that I'm using is a sea salt. But salt will help bring the water liquid out of the tomatoes. Just some black pepper here. Toward the end, I'll taste it and probably add more. I'll continue to stir this for 5 minutes or so while the tomatoes heat up and start to soften. Well, it's been less than 5 minutes and they've already reduced in volume quite a bit, and some of the skins have started to come off the tomatoes, which doesn't make any difference. This gets put in a blender and blended and then put through a sieve, or I'm thinking I might use my French kitchen mill and just put it through that to get rid of the seeds and the skins and whatever from the tomatoes. But as you can see, it's already made quite a bit of juice itself that's just coming out of the tomatoes, and it smells delicious. Brendan, tastes anywhere near as good as it smells. It's going to be a great soup. Now I will add the stock. And bring this to a boil and let it simmer for 45 minutes to an hour, whatever, until everything has cooked up and is nice and soft. I'm kind of disappointed that it isn't a deep purple. Brendan put his through a blender or a food processor and then through a sieve to remove the seeds and skins that were left behind. I'm going to use a hand blender. And then I'm going to put the finished product through my French mill here and see if that will remove the seeds and whatever. I've already tasted the broth while it was cooking, and if you don't like a lot of heat, maybe you shouldn't use 4 Thai chilies like I used. Actually, there are many other kinds of chilies that you could use. I'm not sure how much I'll actually get. I guess there's some skins there. When I put it through, I'll get that. Anyway, this is nice and spicy, which is what I like. But if you didn't care for a lot of heat, I think perhaps a couple of the Thai chilies would be enough. Or one of the other less hot chilies like jalapeno or something like that. Anyway, I'll set up and get ready and we'll show what it looks like going through the French mill. I always wish this mill had extendable things on the bottom here so that it would fit every bowl, but it doesn't. So it doesn't exactly fit this large bowl that I'm using, but I think that's going to work quite well. Yeah. Well, I'll clean that seeds and pulp and stuff, whatever, out there and carry on and meet you in the dining room shortly. Well, actually, that's not a bad color for a tomato soup. I'm going to gild the lily a bit here. Some shavings of Parmesan. A few oyster crackers. I don't know. Many of you people probably don't know what an oyster cracker is. I suspect it's a New England thing. I can't find them even in Canadian stores, but I've had them all of my life. It's just a little round cracker that we put in soups and chowders. And on that, I will drizzle a little more of the extra virgin olive oil. And let's give this spicy soup a try. That is very good. It's still a little nippy, a little spicy, but blending all the vegetables together, the potatoes and whatever, has made it a bit milder. But it's really quite to my taste. Well, I really like it. Well, there is enough, Brendan, that I will be freezing some for use on some of these cold winter snowy days that are coming. But thank you everybody very much for watching, and I hope you give Brendan's soup a try. And even if you don't make the soup, go watch Brendan's video. It's very funny.